Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the 12th episode of season 2 of Coffee with Ashish. And today we've got a very special guest with us, Mr. Afzal Patel ji. As you all fondly know him as chairman of Atlas Travels. And I think it's a pretty unique combination because I think in season 1, we had Hussein also joining us on Coffee with Ashish. So it's one of the rare father-son combos we have had on this show. And had the honor of having you both. I think for everybody's reference, it's a very, very interesting company. It's a very interesting organization. And to the best of my knowledge, I think I was reading that the journey of Atlas Travels began in 87. I was born in 87. So I can only imagine the amount of hard work and the efforts that have been put on by Afzal ji and his entire family. And we can all celebrate such entrepreneurs. I know only VC funding and those kind of startups and companies get into limelight, but I think it's so amazing to see true hardcore local entrepreneurs coming out of India who have sustained and built profitable companies over 4 decades. And I think it's really, really amazing and inspirational, Afzal ji. And even the mission of the organization I was reading about, just wanted to share with everyone who has joined us today, was a mix of philanthropy and actually wanted to do something good. Because as most of you know, that the company started with the idea of, the travel to Islam's holiest shrines in Hajj and Umrah. So it's a very, very, something which is very close to the heart of a large population of the world. And to be able to create a unique experience to make them, feel so personalized and empowered to take on that special journey and to be part of them for that journey. I think it's a very interesting and unique value proposition. And I think over the years, the company has diversified. They are one of the few companies who have embraced technology as well. And I remember having conversation with Hussein, I think a few months back, where he talked about TripJack and how B2B consolidation is also brought into picture. So I think it's a absolutely amazing session lined up, and we look forward to getting pearls of wisdom from Afzal bhai, who's going to tell us so many interesting stories and anecdotes in terms of along his journey, which he picked up, and he'll probably share with us how to and it'll be really interesting, right? Because you would have seen so many ups and downs in this journey of 4 decades. So I'm sure this is just a small kink for many of us. It's one of the largest tragedies which we have seen, but I'm sure from your experience we learn how to go past such small kinks in the entire lifetime. So with this, a very warm welcome to our show, Afzal ji, on Coffee with Ashish. We welcome you. We are really honored and privileged to have you with us, and I'm going to request Ashish to welcome you and have a conversation with you while I enjoy my coffee.
Thank you for the kind words.
Yes,
thank you.
Welcome, Afzal. Yeah. And as your website says, I'll take you up on that, to help community fulfill obligations of a lifetime to travel to Islam's holiest shrines. That's a statement you make. And a journey which began in 1987, 88. So tell us more about this Hajj, Umrah and Ziyarat journeys, and obviously how they get impacted with COVID, and where do you see them beyond COVID times, of course? Will they change fundamentally, or what would they look like?
Okay. So I would start this at where I started my travel agency in the year 87, after I immediately finished my school. And this was in the early 80s. So I didn't do formal education, I didn't do higher education, I would say. I was a very impatient guy at that time. Was always wanting to jump the gun and come on business as soon as possible. I don't know why, because business was something was always inspiring me. My dad was a very successful businessman on his own way, in his own way. Like, he was a transporter. He was having his own transport company as economic transport. His father, my grandfather, was a landlord, and they were into construction business. And they had a hotel business also, my dad. But all these things were not really helping me or exciting me as to what I was looking at. So 5 years or 6 years down the line, I was wandering. I was traveling. Before becoming a travel agent, I was a traveler. So also that comes from the genes from where my father also was like traveling, and he used to take us on holidays. The more at the drop of a hat, we used to go on holidays. So that was the time in 30, 40 years back, which was very something not regular. And I must have done my Bombay, Delhi road trips maybe 20 times with him. And I must have traveled to Kanyakumari also maybe 5 to 10 times along with him in the car.
Oh, wow. Mm.
So that was 5 years was whiling away. It was not something which I was searching for something. In between, I like tried and did some businesses, like business of perfumes, business of garments. But somehow it was giving me money, but it was not exciting. And as destiny would be, that I had a friend and my cousin who was working in Doha. And he came up and asked my dad. He was actually on a job. He was working for a company which was selling encyclopedia. And he was a general manager there. So he came and told me, what are you doing? Why are you wasting time here? Let's go out and do something there. And I think as a salesman, you would be able to do something better over there. So I said, okay, let's go. No issues. But my father was very hesitant. He said no to it because he said my job, my son would never work for someone. So as a salesman, I said, boss, this is not, he's not, we are not getting salaries. It's all commission based. So as it is, the commission is not a salary. It's the more I will work for it, then the more I will be incentivized. So somehow I think he also agreed to it. And I went out to Doha. So Doha was a very something which I could see on the other side of the table when I was working, because it was something where we need to go door to door and do sales or selling encyclopedia, which was in very tough times those days. But somehow I could crack people and was able to really sell it and make really good money also. Since bachelorhood, I didn't have any obligation to send back money. So again, it was chilling and everything. And it so happened that in my 2 year stint there, I got the opportunity that the Hajj season came in. So I asked the company whether I could take a short holiday and go out to Saudi Arabia from Qatar and perform my Hajj and come back. And the company agreed to it. And they said, fine. And I wanted to do this again by road. Although the flights were much cheaper than going by road, but as it would have been in India, I went from there also by road. I wanted to see the sand dunes and the Arabian Peninsula. Once I reached Saudi Arabia, I could see a lot of Indians that come there, a lot of other nationalities, and there was a lot of struggle. And people had come, but they had no proper housing, or they had no proper eating facilities. And this is what was there at the back of my mind. And after I finished my Doha, I said, then it got a bit too much of being a small market, so there wasn't much to do. And apart from like, the excitement got over. I thought it's now, let's call it a day. I never wanted to stay back. I'm always a homesick person. So I came back to India and I started this travel agency called Atlas Tours. And here, as the experience of Makkah, which was there, and I could clearly see this is an opportunity and people would go for it because it is something which is a lifetime journey for someone which is very close to his heart. And we being someone who are very familiar in the community, so the trust factor which was there. So in spite of everything, the first year we could book was only 16 people. Economically, it was not viable. But the commitment was there. So we said, let's go. And I would say, let's go ahead with it. And it was such a huge success because the delivery part was always there from the heart. Because although it was business, But yes, but then it was very emotional as well, because the people who are coming in have a very different approach. They have not come here to look at the scenery around or something like that. So it was a very emotional kind of approach for them. And here we excelled very well. And the next year onwards, I would say it was maybe 500 to 600 times multiples people joined us. And from there on, I think we have never looked back. So this is how I started my travel agency. And one more thing important was that we never restricted ourselves to being into one part of the game. So always looking at different kind of businesses, because if I would recall, in those days, travel agencies who were doing recruitment were doing only recruitment.
Right.
Consolidators were only doing consolidation.
Right.
European tour operators or European ticketing agent would do only Europe. Gulf travel agent would do only Gulf ticketing.
Correct. I remember that.
So this is one thing which we said to ourselves that I would not do this. I would take anything and everything, even if it's a rail ticket coming or even if it's a domestic ticket coming. If you may remember those days, it was only Indian Airlines at that time.
Correct.
And Indian Airlines was always on a wait list. But we were never saying no to anything, because I wanted every spectrum of customers coming to us, so that tomorrow and future, I should not be labeled only as one particular city. There are so many verticals into travel. So we tried and explored everything. And I was very fortunate enough to have my brothers along with me. And my brothers really helped out and delegated things to them into every different verticals. And this is how the journey started. It is something when I really cherish and I look back. So it was really nice.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned about the community trusted you. There was a trust factor. And I think in Hajj, Umrah and Ziyarat, the trust factor is a very important factor for people.
It's nothing but trust.
Yeah. I could.
It's nothing but trust, because they have a very different kind of a perspective.
Approach, yes.
They look upon things in a very different fashion. Mm-hmm. So here, trust is something very important. And since many people, I would say, Ashish, they, at those days especially, they were like coming to us with their lifetime savings.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
So we used to show them maybe 80% and deliver 100%. So that always that 20% was always been a surprise factor for them, which they had never expected. So this is where I feel, and then the referral started. We were into like a lot of marketing those days. However, the marketing was happening, like customer engagement through mailers or through post. We were used to send gifts to them on occasions, on festivities and festivals. But the main issue, I think, was that they were like, how would I explain is, we used to touch them, because I can still get today, even today, people come to the office and they narrate their stories. I may have forgotten what we have done with them. Mm-hmm. My brother Saeed, who is there on specially, who takes care of the operations of Saudi Arabia. And people come and tell them that this is the point where you have helped me. This is one point where you helped my mother. This is one where you did something to my father. And this has really touched me and I cannot forget. And these very people are now referring. So we have a lot of referrals. Advertisement is something which can keep you. Maybe it's you are present in the market. But real business comes to, I feel, it's reference.
Correct. I was actually going to move away to the next question as the learnings for the younger generation. But I can easily summarize the learnings even today that even in the any kind of holiday business or travel business, trust is an important factor. Referral, customer referral is an important factor. Building the trust and loyalties of customer is a factor. And even today, when you talk about digital age, which will go forward,
yes.
it's the stories you build around your holiday, right? If you look at modern tools like Instagram, what is it? It's building the stories around the holiday.
Stories.
And you
know, we have to be really good storytellers.
Correct. So you have just conveyed it. And in the 80s, people reminded you as to what all, you know, Atlas and you have done for them.
I would say my customers only taught my business.
Yes.
As what their requirement was. And they used to come and tell us that we need to do this. And especially in 91, when the economy had opened up, the Indian currency became convertible. And there was a lot of new opportunity which came in. And at that time, the business where we are located, like my first office, the head office which was there, and I was very fortunate
to Muhammad have Ali Road. You still have that in Muhammad Ali Road?
Yeah, I have that. Yeah. And that office was, I would say, the location in those days was something which was very critical.
It is important. Yes.
Very important.
Yes.
Today it's okay. We will mind wherever you are. But yeah, those days, and I was really fortunate to have a very good location with a 60 feet wide frontage and 2,400 square feet of prime location. And that gave a real good kind of a huge impact in the market. And people used to walk in, and there was a lot of customer engagement happening. So they themselves used to give us their requirements. They were like traders who had started going out to China. So we could see that now China is a good market. Then people started going out to the Middle East. And then now the tour businesses, like where people are like traveling to Europe and USA. So we had in our bouquet everything available to offer.
So lastly, on
consolidation was also one part of it.
Yeah.
But because of the impact of the Hajj and Umrah in the Atlas name was so much that the consolidation business was never like looked upon seriously by the market.
Right. But tell me lastly, of course, on the holy business, are you restricted by licenses? I mean, you have to be empaneled and there is a certain number of people you can carry, or it's an open market?
Yes.
What do you see it as a future? My idea is, where do you see it as a future?
See, regulations are there and regulations will always be there. But I foresee that today with the New India happening, I see and how the ministry is also looking, our ministry especially, the Saudi ministry, how they are looking upon this. I think the gates would open up.
Right.
And there would not be anything like the Hajj committee which is there. Maybe because since there is no subsidy anymore on the Hajj. Earlier, last 2-3 years back, the subsidy has gone away. So the subsidy was one area where the government was subsidizing.
The demand was created.
Yes. So that subsidy is already reducing every time. And every year, like it's almost about 10%, it's getting reduced. So here I see a very good... again, an opportunity, because if customers really have to choose between government or they want to go by private, so they would definitely opt for it.
Right.
And there is something which I feel it will happen very soon.
A thought which comes into my mind, of course, the Reserve Bank holds you back. But today, the Indian companies like yours could actually look after the entire SAARC region for Hajj and Umrah, because, you know, countries like Maldives and so on may not be so well established in terms of putting this together as you are perhaps in India.
Yeah, of course, because we see, we have a really good kind of a setup in SAARC.
Yes.
And that is helping us to cater to more and more people. We always work on economics of scale. That's my forte always. That the customer has to have the best of something for a song. So the infrastructure in Saudi Arabia is very important. Saudi Arabia is a market which is very complex. It is something very process-driven environment over there. And to have a setup into Saudi Arabia is helping us like servicing the kind of people which we and the numbers which we have. So any amount of, like today, as what you said, if Maldives people want to be serviced there,
correct.
We are able to do that.
I think this is where the government needs to sit up and take note in terms of the FEMA regulation, with the Prime Minister himself saying local go global. Here's a perfect opportunity for a
it
local.
It is absolutely perfect. It is a perfect.
Great. So let's move on. And interestingly, you mentioned about your, I think, grandfather being in the hotel business. And then you
had. He had a small hotel.
Right.
He had his own transport company. He had his own warehousing business. All this was there. Yeah.
Right. So where did this Grand Residency Hotels, which you, I saw the website again, very smart. How did it come in and where does it fit in?
Grand Residency, I would say, whatever I have done in my life, I say, was always by gut. So it was nothing that we had a very, so we had, I had consultants and looked at things, how it would shape up. So there was a land parcel in Bandra, where it's Bollywood is there. And I was fortunate enough to get a good large land parcel over there. And during the time, it was 98, 99, where there was a very slump in the real estate industry. So certain such properties were never available. And I was fortunate enough to get it. So first it was, let's buy it and see what will happen. And it so happened in one of my visit to Dubai, and where I was in hanging out in the balcony, I could see a service apartment. I still remember the name, Golden Sand Service Apartments. So I just barged into that service apartment and looked into it as what's happening and what kind of, it was something new in those days. So that I find that it's quite exciting and a new kind of a concept which is not there in India. And if it works in Bombay, especially in Bandra, where people would really want to come and stay there, and corporate especially. So immediately after coming back, we made up our mind that there's nothing doing, but we'll make, build a hotel and a service apartment here.
Right.
And it was a huge success from day one, I would say.
So, Afzal, I will tell the youngsters who may be hearing us now.
Yeah.
I haven't heard you say anything in your life journey which is actually not a lesson for today's youngster. Because you have demonstrated in your own life the need to have that urge to do something, the need to find the right gap at the right time. And
very important. Credibility. Right time. You have to start taking your risk as well.
Yeah.
You have to have your... people around you. That's very important, to have nice people around you. I always look upon and tell my sons that even Akbar had his Navratans.
Yes.
So,
correct, absolutely.
Yeah, so why? So it is always not me. It is people who are you surrounded with. So I was like, as I am fortunate enough to have my brothers and my other things and my team along with me. Similar, the same thing I've been telling my both my sons, that this is the way forward, and things are there, ups and downs will come and go. Nothing is permanent in life. Yeah. The pre-COVID days are not there. So even the COVID days will never remain. Yeah. Things will change on it. Keep moving.
Yeah, that's all about teamwork, and HR practitioners would draw lessons.
You have to really be fortunate enough, have to have good people around you.
Right. So here's the question. If you were to start circa 1987 and you have to start all over again, and you barged into your father and say, I want to do something, this is not, what would you do again if you were to replicate?
See, or would you do it all over again? Wearing so many hats. So I would say I've never ended. So there is nothing like a startup for me now. So every day is a startup. Every, like the new thing which we have done is the trip jack. And TripJack, when Hussein joined me in 2010, and I was also, again, I would say that I know many of my friends whose new generation never entered into this business for whatever reasons it may be. But here Hussein was very inclined to join into the business, but he wanted to do it in his own way.
Right.
And technology is something which always fascinated me. I think, excuse me, there's some issue.
Oh, yeah, fire alarm.
Excuse me.
Yeah, you okay?
Yeah, it's fine. Okay. You okay?
Go ahead, please. So technology and startup.
The technology part was always close to my heart. Mm. I think being a lazy person, so technology can do wonders for you. So I always adapted to technology very early in my life. Mm. If I may say this, so like when BSP went out with the auto ticket printer, so the autopilot project when it was implemented.
Right.
And, Kiran Yadav, if I may recall.
I remember Kiran, I know him.
Kiran.
Yeah.
So Kiran, although we were into consolidation at that time for ticketing, and he put in our name in place of some other consolidators. And I readily accepted. So he got a bit surprised and he asked me, Afzal, are you sure you want this? Because others have said no. I say, I don't know why they have said no to it, but I really appreciate this because it would give a very clean ticket.
Right.
And why we want to write tickets and this and that.
Uh-huh.
Then they asked him, why are they refusing? They may also have their good reasons for not taking it.
Right.
So he said, yes, if you may recall that those days when there was a ticket stock, the physical ticket stocks which were there, and every fortnight there was a rate change.
Yes.
So to take advantage of that rate change would have not been possible if you were using the
automated
tickets. Stock.
Yeah.
So I said, fine, this is okay, but 2 or 3 months will pass on and I'll manage. Mm. So technology adaption has always fascinated me. And that is lucky enough that my sons also are imbibing technology every day. So that is how TripJack was recoined. And we looked at, he wanted to do his own way. So I said, fine. Because this business of Haji Numbra was really overshadowing the business of consolidation. And he has his own views, his own focus and target. So it is working fine.
Right. So let me put your brains on the future of this B2B business as we see it today.
Yeah.
My own thoughts from where I sit, Afzal, and I keep challenging myself that I don't see this model, I won't use the word surviving, but don't see this model in the way it is today and in the next 3 years. What are
skeptical
your now. I'm very skeptical.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Okay. So there are plenty of people like that.
Yeah.
And then always good to have skepticism as well as positivity.
Right.
Because if everyone is positive and everyone is negative, the same. So there is somebody extra in the room.
Right.
I personally see that if two people are sitting in the room and they are of the same opinion, one is an extra.
Yeah. All right.
So. Here, my point of view of B2B is this, that see, there is so much of content on the net that today a consumer, when he comes to anybody like a travel agent, today we are not dealing with one-to-one customers mostly because we have all gone online and our customers are travel agents. So they always, the customer, when he walks into them, he comes with some kind of a mind.
Yeah.
That I need this, that, and there's so much to consume that there will always be a requirement like a consultant, I would say. A today's travel agent has to be more acting like a consultant than becoming a travel agent. He himself has to be very updated up to what is he doing, because the customer will see value to it, because a small package, like today, ticketing is one aspect. It's become, it's a 1 hour journey or maybe 5 hour journey.
Correct.
But the entire experience where a customer is expecting is when he goes and stays for 5 nights or 10 nights. So there you have to do a lot of things. And while he is on the tour, he doesn't want to risk that, I feel. And he needs someone who can support him and guide him. So here I see that always, like USA, if you see, it's a very matured market. But still, there is B2B happening over there. So I see B2B still has got life. It will go on. And there would be one market for it.
So what you're really saying, from a current transactional model, which is, you know, buy, pay, out. It will become a very consultative position.
Very consultative.
Right? And I resonate well with that. I remember when 9% commission changed to 5% commission, 3%, zero in the airline business.
Right.
And we were really commission agents for airlines. We weren't agents for customers. And we used to keep telling everybody that if you want, zero commission will go away, I mean, will come into place, take it as a fait accompli. So you have to become a consultant for travel, for corporates. You have to guide corporates. And this is what's happened in the corporate travel business. You're guiding corporates on their travel budgets.
Exactly.
You're drafting their travel policies for them.
Right.
And you're helping them maintain their travel policies for them, including the MIS and tracking of their customers.
Everything.
Right?
Yes.
So that's where the corporate travel business has found its niche. And I think what you're saying is this is where perhaps the totality of the business, be it holiday, domestic, be it outside, be it anywhere, maybe find a niche where the customers will not only have more information they want to know, but, you know, keeping track of their entire movement on a palm-based or a mobile-based entities and so on.
Yes. So for that, we need to keep evolving with the customers as their requirements. So as we see in the project, as we see it with a new lens, like till today, it was only the focus was for agent selling experience. We used to bring in more and more content to the travel agent.
Right.
Now the focus of next 3 years is empowering our travel agents to reach to their end users. That is the focus on. And I find it really interesting when the boys are talking to me and the way things are being looked at. It really excites me because this will enable our travel community, our travel partners who are dealing with us, how do they approach to their customers? So,
no, you said it early on that your customers taught you this business.
It's always the case, and
I think the way you're saying it, and this is what's going to be happening in future more, because you have to be two steps ahead of your customer. Otherwise, they're not going to. How can you advise them?
Absolutely.
Right. Absolutely. Great. So when Afzal when Hussein was on the show, you had just launched the IPL package.
Yeah.
So concludingly, just tell me, what was the success? How did that go? Give us a summary of what happened there.
See, cricket in India is like everywhere. No need for any introduction.
Yeah, yeah.
It's very close to everybody's heart.
Except today we scored 36 runs for the old.
Yes. So during the COVID period, and since we people cannot sit, I must tell you very honestly, we keep thinking of something or the other. Every night, the father-son duo sits down and we chit-chat. Yeah. And look at things, okay, what is this new thing we can do? And something like this came up and we were watching and this crick buzz and all these things. So I asked Hussein, whether can we do something like that?
Yeah.
And immediately he agreed to it. And then the model was built around. And it was huge, as I was saying. People really appreciated that. They were participating. A lot of engagement happening. So it is again a customer supplier relationship, which keeps them on, and that's something which they feel, yes, we are dealing with the right people who are there at every time. So during those days, although travel had started, the unlocking already had happened, but the engagement was really good, and they, I think, gave away a lot, many TJ coins, as they call it, the trip check coins, and people are encashing it. And I'm happy about it, that it was really appreciated by people.
Great, Afzal, been a pleasure talking to you. I entered the travel industry in 1979.
Okay.
And I always look forward to finding people who I can go historically back, because these days you can't easily find people like that. Because, you know, but anyway, like you said, the main thing is you have evolved, you had interest in technology, and that's what helped you. And in any ways, on my personal front, and that's what helped me keep pace with people like Karthik, who's on the screen, and he's a technology guy. So may I hand you back to Karthik if he has something to conclude? And I look forward to chatting up with you as we go forward in life.
Anytime. Thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure.
It's a pleasure indeed. Over to you, Karthik.
Yeah, I have one question I want to ask you. It's more like a advice. So you started, you mentioned, with the business, which was not purely transactional for you because it was very close to your heart and it had a larger purpose and people were coming with their life savings and whatnot. It was a very specialized business, right? So you put your heart and soul into it and it was a very emotional business, if I may say. Then you said you moved into an arena where you said we'll do anything and everything under the sun, which means a lot of transactional business as well, pure play ticketing anywhere around the world. How did you maintain that balance of not being making the mistake of, you cannot force one business model into the other because it will not work, right? What works for Hajj and Umrah will not work for other lines of travel business. So how did you maintain that balance as an entrepreneur?
Why we need to mix everything? Because Hajj and Umrah business is something which had its own team, and the other businesses, as I said, which were like consolidation as it happened, because there was a Gulf boom happening at that time, and if I would have not really gone for it, I would be looking stupid today. Because so there was no compromise as such over one business was bleeding, the other was taking care of certain things which normally people haven't. It wasn't, it didn't have that kind of a thing. And whatever we did, the important factor which I feel was that prestige should not never be compromised. So if I am dealing with a travel agent, if I am dealing with a niche customer which is close to my heart, or be it anything in my day-to-day life, there are friends, there are people who are in our industry people. So relationships have to be maintained at all cost. So here I would say is one thing, that's why I'm not able to mix the one thing with the other.
Great.
I think if I may just add the cement, Karthik, to what you said, it really comes down that irrespective of the nature and characteristic of the business, if you keep the fundamentals of human characters and relationships
very important,
core and substance, you will be able to cut across all verticals.
Absolutely. I think Ashish, you have said it.
Right.
Well, thank you so much. Anything else,
Karthik? Yeah, I think that's anyways a lot of information for a youngster like me to process. So thank you so much for sharing these thoughts with us. And thanks, Ashish, as always. Thank you, everyone, for joining in today. And we'll see you next week. Thanks again, Afzalji, for being with us.
Thanks.
Look forward.
Look forward.